I'm just going to use my regular voice to welcome you all to Tuesday's War and Peace Lecture Series. Our topic tonight is the power of nonviolence as a transformative force in the world. We are joined by an expert in this, the founder of the Peace Studies Program at UC Berkeley, who is now a retired professor. Originally, your discipline was in languages and literature and the classics, mm-hmm. and you moved from that to the study of peace. He's internationally and nationally known on these topics. He's been speaking with us up here for as long as I've been involved with the War and Peace Program, which is at least a decade. And he's one of the great speakers, and we're so delighted to have Michael Nagler join us every year. You'll see a few more people always come from the community because they want to hear Michael's voice and vision. He told me he's speaking again tomorrow night at Dominican University. So we're especially lucky tonight to have Michael Nagler join us to speak with us about the power of nonviolence. So please welcome him.
Thank you very much, Tim, and very happy to see all of you here. Can everybody hear me? Everybody who wants to? Yeah. Okay. If you can't hear me, just raise your hand and I'll know you can't hear me. Before we begin, I'd like to show you a clip from a film called Beyond Rangoon, which was not a tremendously successful movie, but it was life-changing for me. And the important thing for you to know about the scene that you're about to see is that it actually happened. You're going to see it enacted, of course, dramatically by some very good actors. Patricia Arquette, American actress. Of course, the film has to revolve around an American. And so that's Patricia Arquette's role. What's happening is she has come to Burma to recuperate from a violent crime that had taken her husband and her child. And she's in a hotel room in what was still then called Rangoon. And what she doesn't know is that there is a rally about to take place, and the famous democracy leader Aung San Suu Kyi is going to be addressing that rally. Now, I actually have a copy of the film where there are subtitles for what the Burmese military are saying to one another, but let's just watch it through her point of view, where of course she doesn't understand what's going on. So they have somehow found an actress who's a lookalike for Aung San Suu Kyi, and I want to direct your attention to, because I don't want to interrupt the clip once it starts, but there's a moment when she's approaching a squad of riflemen, and so one of her people puts his hand on her shoulder as if to say, don't go. She dismisses him. She starts to walk up. The captain in charge says, ready, aim. They point their rifles directly at her, and then the camera focuses on her face. And I want you to watch very carefully. She's an awfully good actress. She goes through a kind of subtle but very deep change at that point, which we're going to discuss when the clip is over. Okay, Drew. Pardon me, I always get just a little bit emotional seeing that scene. But I hope you were able to see what she's going through the way I see it. There's just a minute there where she seems to be saying to herself, are you prepared to die? And she says, yeah. And she walks on through. Now, this actually happened to Aung San Suu Kyi twice. And what I'd like to do tonight is really revolving around that whole dynamic of what exactly did happen. Because, you know, we say that political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. They had all of these guns, and she had all the power. I was just talking with Tim and Roshni and some others before we came in here. Realized it's an unusual situation we have in Burma today. I mean, certainly I don't like to call it Myanmar. For me, it's Burma. Maybe it's old-fashioned, maybe it's a political thing. but it's a strange situation where you have a tremendous charismatic leader, but no movement. She hasn't really been able to collect a movement around her. And if you ask yourself why Burma is such a disastrous situation, even President Obama, speaking with her 2 days ago in Rangoon, pointed out that there's tremendous violence between the Buddhists and the Rohingya, the Burmese Muslims. Well, this is what happens to a country which is devastated. It turns around and becomes violent. This is why we have ISIS in the Middle East today. You may be aware that when the British withdrew from Burma ahead of the Japanese advance, they decided to follow the scorched earth policy, basically devastated the place. Then when the Japanese withdrew, they did the same thing, thank you, had another scorched earth policy, and it left the country psychologically devastated. Now, so in the beginning of the rally, they're holding pictures of a military person. That is Aung San Suu Kyi's father, General Aung San, who liberated the country from the British and then from the Japanese, but he was assassinated shortly after taking office because of the violence that was boiling in that civilization. In the midst of all of that violence, she arises with the purest nonviolence spirits. She hasn't written much, but there's enough. So, to approach this, I thought I'd begin by sharing an image with you. My career, my life path has been bracketed, bookended the way the United States itself is bookended between two empires. I came from the Empire State, which you may not be aware is what we call ourselves back in New York. The city is the Big Apple, but the state is the Empire State. And now I live in the Redwood Empire. So this is somehow kind of putting me where I need to be to resist the belly of the beast. But right after I graduated from college, I had a job at NYU Medical Center. And I would get out of the Lexington Avenue subway on 32nd Street, walk up to 34th, and walk over to the east side to go to work. And there was one block, one entire block was one building. And I kept noticing this, how strange, you know, store after store after store, it was all one building. And one day I decided to find out what it was, and, you know, I didn't mind being a little bit late for work, so I got across the street, which in New York is a trick, and from the other side of the street, I looked up, oh my God, it was the Empire State Building. It was the tallest building in the world, and I'd been crawling past it day after day without really understanding where I was. And so I want to use this as a kind of allegory. I want to take some phenomena of nonviolence from the really, really biggest picture. Hey, let's go way across the street and look way up there and ask ourselves, where have we come from and where are we today? And I really mean it when I say the big picture. I'm going to start with the Big Bang. I'm going to cover 13.7 billion years in three sentences. So fasten your seatbelts. You know, here we go. The first fact about the universe, which is useful to know, is that this superb, meticulously nuanced universe of ours with these incredible human bodies and these minds could not possibly have come about by chance. I used to be taught that it all just happened by chance. Superficial Darwinism was right, and throw enough molecules together and you'll come up with a medical school professor. But they're actually able now to do some math on what the likelihood is. So near where I live, out on the coast, there's a very big junkyard. It must be like about 2 acres full of junk. And when I say junk, it's everything imaginable, like old refrigerators, tractor parts, television sets, barbed wire, dead animals, you name it. Now imagine if a cyclone was to sweep through that junkyard and whip all these pieces together and put together a Boeing 707. Do you think that's very likely? I mean, you know, I'm a humanities man. I don't remember the numbers, but it's 1 over an incredibly long number. It is so unlikely that, to be realistic, you have to say that it's impossible. And the chances that our universe came about by chance are exactly the same. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, if it didn't come about by chance, well, then it has some purpose, or at least some direction, some drive. And I think it's safe to say that evolution hasn't stopped, and we can assume that that purpose has not yet been reached. Okay? So let's just revisit those three facts and look at them a little bit more closely. The universe did not come about by chance. What has it been doing for 13 billion years? You know, another way of looking at it is, people say that if a monkey were sitting at a typewriter long enough, it would type out the plays of Shakespeare, but they calculated that too, and it's like 7,000 billion years it would take this poor animal to do it. And in only 13 billion years, the universe created monkeys, typewriters, and Shakespeare. So this begins to give us a clue. If you look back at evolution, what you see is a constant progression in consciousness. Now, the mystics would say that consciousness has not been evolving. Consciousness always is. But clearly, there are forms which are evolving, which are capable of capturing and utilizing higher and higher consciousness, really dramatically higher by leaps of magnitude. We have a dog who visits us at the Metta Center. I think you may have seen Fancy. She is a very sweet animal, getting all nostalgic just thinking about how I left her locked up in the office. She's very intelligent. She's capable of responding to affection, wags her tail like crazy. But the fact is, she is still just a dog. And she did come into the office the other day with a rabbit. So I don't think we should be sentimental about this. We are a huge quantum leap beyond even the nearest animal, even the primates. There is a lot of nonviolent behavior in primates, but when you come to Aung San Suu Kyi, it's very different. You don't see primates, you know, even bonobos, who are the most nonviolent ones of all. They have terrific conflict avoidance mechanisms, but if you point a rifle at them, they don't gulp twice and say, well, I'm prepared to face death and walk through you, and they don't respond to that kind of nonviolence either. So consciousness has been rising. That's the second proposition. There is a purpose to it all. And the third proposition, that purpose has not been reached yet, because clearly even classics professors, even SSU students, have not reached the pinnacle of what human consciousness is capable of. There, I said it, and I'm glad. I hope you don't resent me for saying that. But when you look at certain figures, a Jesus, a Buddha, and I'm going to add in our own age, a Mahatma Gandhi, a Martin Luther King Jr., you see people in whom the rise of consciousness has probably perfected itself. It's probably reached its conclusion. Mrs. Gandhi was once asked by an American journalist, how many children do you have? And she said, well, it depends who you ask. I have four. My husband has 400 million, which was the population of India at that time. Now, what she was implying, and which was true, and which the American journalist probably didn't get, is that his love for the meanest person in India was as intense as her love was for her four natural children. So this is a criterion for measuring the rise of consciousness. How many other beings can we embrace as our own? And by that measure, it's extremely inspiring to note, and yet again challenging to note, that some human individuals have carried this out quantum leaps beyond what you and I are presently capable of. So where we stand today is that we are badly in need of a decisive shift in direction. I don't say it's a shift in condition because I don't think it's realistic for us to think about going from a violent world, which frankly is where we're at right now, to a nonviolent one. But it is possible for us to think realistically about changing the direction in which we are going. I just read yesterday, I hope this won't offend you again, I imagine some of you like video games a lot, but there's this one young fellow, you have to pardon my resentment here, he makes more in 1 year than I've made in my entire career by playing violent video games and letting other people look over his shoulder. So now I have to drop back here a little bit and give you a distressing bit of background. You may or may not be aware of the work of Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman, wrote a book called On Killing and Let's Stop Teaching Our Kids to Kill. He was a real lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Army, and he popularized the fact that was discovered a few years ago, well, some years ago now, that up until the Korean War, the firing rate in an average platoon or company or whatever was 15%, even in the midst of an attack. In other words, your men could be dug in there, so you have 100 people with automatic weapons and rifles, and they're being attacked. There's a charge coming across the field. 15 out of those 100 men will actually fire at the enemy. The others will shoot up in the air, or they won't shoot at all, and this has been going on as far as we can tell. In Antietam and Gettysburg and other battle sites, they have recovered these, you know, muzzle-loading rifles will have like 15 or 18 balls in the barrel because the men, you know, level down, they pretend that they fired, they look around, make sure nobody noticed they didn't shoot, and then they go and they reload, unquote. And the explanation for this turned out to be that there's an enormous inhibition against, am I doing something? Sorry. Thank you for your patience. There's that we have it built within us an enormous inhibition against injuring or killing other people. And unfortunately, when this was discovered after the Korean War, the military hired some psychologists and got about the business of fixing this problem. And by the Vietnam War, they had boosted the firing rate to 85-90%. And how did they do that? By showing recruits video games. And not special video games that they went out and manufactured. They just went out to your local video droid and picked them off the shelf. So these are the same games that people a little bit younger than you and don't have as much studying to do are watching day in and day out. So the direction that we're headed in, as characterized by a colleague of mine at Berkeley, is that we are increasing violence by every means possible. So you look around the world today and you see an enormous amount of violence, but what you don't see is the behind that picture, the explanation, the infrastructure. We are increasing violence in very sophisticated, very powerful ways, relentlessly. And that's what I'm saying we have to change, to find out where and how we're doing this and start doing the opposite. So what would that look like? What if we made progress towards not just the symptoms of violence, but violence itself? Clarify what I'm saying here. Gandhi said that while he was, of course, involved in the liberation of India, he did that for 35 years, he made it happen, that really wasn't his purpose, he confessed. His purpose was not even to bring down the colonial system, which he did. His purpose was to give the world an ocular demonstration of the power of nonviolence. And in the 1930s, he was visited by Thurgood Marshall from the, I guess it was called the Harlem Renaissance at that time. And They begged him to come to America, but he followed a policy called Swadeshi, or localism. He said, if I come to America, I'll lose everything that I've been working on in India and gain nothing in America. But he said, if I can succeed in creating this ocular demonstration, someone in America can pick it up and use it from there. And I figured out that Martin Luther King was 8 years old at that time. So King himself, as you know, went through a big shift in 1967. I'm going to say two things about that. He shifted from the category of civil rights to the category of war. He took off against the Vietnam War in a famous speech. I think it was on June 4th in the Empire State. And people criticized him for this. You're leaving us behind. You're shifting to another field. We won't be able to follow you. He said, no, what I'm doing is getting down to the root cause. So the root cause of racism is violence. If we can eliminate racism without eliminating violence, the racism will come back. And alas, that seems to be exactly what happened. He created a real setback for racism, but he wasn't able to go far enough to convert us from violence to nonviolence, and the racism's, well, welcome to Ferguson, Mississippi. And the other thing I want to say, which again is kind of demoralizing about that change of his, it seems to be certainly the case that this is what got him assassinated. A friend of mine has written a series of four exquisitely researched books on the assassinations of Martin Luther King, JFK, MLK, Malcolm X, Bobby Kennedy, and he also wrote one on Gandhi, assassination of Gandhi. And in the four American cases, the issue that provoked that act of extreme violence was the person making a challenge to the war system. And I say this because I think we can use this information strategically. It creates the possibility that we can work on aspects of violence which don't create this reaction, and we can undercut the war system. We can sneak up on it. Like, for example, we're pretty close to actually seeing a major campaign in certain enlightened parts of the United States, like Santa Rosa, Sonoma County, to bring about restorative justice in schools. This is doable. People don't want their kids to be criminalized. They don't distrust their kids as much as they distrust an adult. If we could bring about restorative justice in schools, there would just be another big step to bring it about in the criminal justice system. And we can go from the criminal justice system to the war system, rather than trying to attack the war system directly. Because after all is said and done, the people who are propagating violence in this world are not using their highest intelligence to do it. And frankly, I think that we can outsmart them. We cannot outspend them. We can't have match them in power, but we can outmatch them in sophistication. We can't quite outmatch them in ruthlessness, but we can match their ruthlessness with our determination. So that would start bringing about the shift in direction that we all want to see, and that we at the Metta Center in our way and you in your way are working on. So if we ask ourselves what that shift would look like, where the change would start to come from, one of the places we would tend to think of about, especially here, given who we are and where we are, is education. So now I want to share another story with you. I am a career educator. My parents were both educators. My grandparents in Europe were both scholars, one kind or another. So going back many generations, I inherited this idea that education was a sacred act. It was a sacred trust, and I went into teaching with that opinion. And in the course of my career, up to the point where I finally pulled the ripcord and got out of Berkeley in 2007, I watched a momentous change take place. And this is the change. If you had asked me or my colleagues when I started my career right after the free speech movement, what is the purpose of education? Well, we would have had some kind of vague idea that it had something to do with helping people rise to their highest potential. I would pipe up as a classicist. And I would say, hey, you know, I have a PhD in classics. Let me weigh in here. The Latin word, educare, means to draw forth, to lead out of someone. So it is to help people to find their deepest potential and bring it out of themselves. And if I had said that, no one asked me, of course, but if I had said that back then, nobody would have thought I was crazy. They might have tittered a little bit, but they wouldn't have thought I was crazy. By the time I left, anyone could tell you what the purpose of education is. It is to make money. Even the lecturer that we almost overlapped with here, that's what it was all about. You ask anyone in the educational system, and they will say the point is to help students get jobs. And I'm telling you this from bitter personal experience. I am going to share some happy things with you today, so hold on, bear with me. This was a drastic reduction in the purpose of education, and I saw it coming. And I spent 20 years there. I was a faculty member at Berkeley. I was on a number of different committees, the purpose of which was to decide on educational policy. So I said to my colleagues over and over again, why don't we have a public forum on the purpose of education? And they said, oh, you mean improving our undergraduate program? I said, no, I mean, what is the purpose of education? For 20 years, all they did was change the subject, turn out the lights, and if possible, get me off the committee. So, and why is it that they were unable to discuss it? Because in their heart, they knew that they had failed at education's most sacred purpose. So I'm saying this partly to incite rebellion in all of you, nonviolent rebellion, to be sure. But we are now occupying a system which has incredible potential, which it is not fulfilling. And we each in our role, student, professor, whatever we are, can see to it that we ask for courses that help us develop an understanding of the purpose of education. It shouldn't be too hard. At one point, because of the free speech movement at Berkeley, we had something called the freshman seminar program. And so you could teach a freshman seminar on anything. So I asked myself, what is it that incoming young people on this campus need most and they will not get? And I designed a course called Why Are We Here? Great Writings on the Meaning of Life. Then I had to face my chairman, of course. So I went in and I said, Don, so, you know, you've seen the title of my course. Don't worry, Don, I'm going to bring in some Plato. He said, Michael, go away. He said, don't do whatever you want and don't tell me about it, okay? So that was my first example of don't tell, don't ask. But it was a hugely successful course. Went on to be a sophomore seminar, and I taught it for more than 15 years. So I want to make two more observations about what happened to the educational system and how it happened. One is, as I've already pointed out, it was, although it was the most important decision that was ever made in the educational field in the United States of America and assumedly elsewhere, it was never discussed. We had committee after committee that was set up to discuss this thing, but it never happened. The other thing I want to point out is that it was across the political spectrum. It was universal. It was a cultural decision. It was not a political decision. Radical students like me were saying, we want courses that are relevant, meaning that will help us make money. The chancellor of the university was going to Sacramento and saying, the University of California is your economic engine that's driving the state, California. So it didn't matter who you were politically, everybody had adopted this huge shift unconsciously. I have a colleague at Berkeley named Carolyn Merchant who wrote a book back in the early 80s called The Death of Nature. And she talked about this huge shift in consciousness in this Western civilization from a belief that the Earth was in some way a living system. It may not have been Mat or Bhumi, may not have been Gaia, you know, your mother, but at least it was living, to this kind of inert rock flying through space with all these minerals in it that we should dig out and use. And once again, this momentous shift happened without a moment's discussion. There was no convention on the mythology of the Earth that took place in the 17th century. And we know why it took place. It took place because the Industrial Revolution was brewing, and you could not blow off mountaintops and dam rivers and dig mines in your mother. So they had to change the myth, and they did. Now, it's appalling how all of this happened, but I also think we can learn something from it, because this is exactly the kind of change that we need to bring about, but in reverse. And we need to do it by reaching very deeply into where people's hearts and minds are at. I do think, though, that we are going to have to do it somewhat consciously, because we need it to happen faster than those changes happen. So let's take a look, and could we go over to my slideshow now, Tim? Should I do that? Okay. And I guess we should take the lights down. Okay, let's see.
Can you switch the laptop down?
All right. I wasn't getting any signals from the laptop.
You may need to use your computer to connect to connect to a display.
Okay. I'm going to take it up there then?
No. It's something you can do on your...
Okay. Right now. Oh, my gosh. Oh wow.
Yeah,
thank you.
If there's a particular image that you want them to see, Michael, slide for a second. Usually we like to keep the focus
okay.
On you.
So. Okay, good. I think it's a good idea. Okay, so that was the introductory slide. And what I'm trying to illustrate now is that one aspect of the change that we're going to have to create, the change in direction from creating violence by every means possible to creating nonviolence by every means possible, it will be a change in alertness. Because fortunately, the world is full of nonviolence, but we are not tuned to detect it. And even if we detect it, we cannot understand it. That's why Metta Center, I'm happy to say, just this week started a massive program for media people, for journalists. We're going to train them to know that nonviolence has happened and be able to interpret when it succeeded and why and so forth. So how many of you have heard of this lovely woman, Antoinette Tuff? Okay, well then, see, that in itself is quite significant, because this woman is a real hero. She was a perfectly ordinary person, and this is important because she was not Aung San Suu Kyi. You know, it's difficult to shoot a person who is the figurehead of an entire nation whom everybody knows. But Antoinette Tough was just the bookkeeper in a school in Decatur, Georgia, where there were 825 children. And one day, about 3 months ago, a very disturbed young man who had what all very disturbed young men can get their hands on in this country, very heavy weapons, an assault rifle, a backpack full of ammunition, and he came into the school in order to kill as many children as possible. So think back for a second about what I was saying about education. You know, when I started teaching, no one would dream of carrying a weapon onto a campus and using it to shoot someone, because education had a kind of sanctity about it, because we were fulfilling a higher purpose. But now schools, I'm sorry, they are just shooting galleries for demented people. So this young man comes in and he announces that he's psychotic, he's off his meds, and this is it, everybody, we're all gonna die here today. He got through the security gate, they're supposed to keep him out. While he's talking to the people in the office, the SWAT teams showed up, so he goes out and shoots at them, and they shoot at him, and he comes back in. Antoinette Tough is behind the desk. She was not even supposed to be there that day. She was covering for somebody else who was sick. And she looked at him and she said, "This is a very disturbed young man, and he has problems, and you know what, I have problems too." She'd just gone through losing her husband of 34 years. She has a disabled child, very difficult to take care of. So she said, "Honey, you don't have to die. Let me tell you, you have problems, you think you have problems, I have problems too." She started talking to him. She said, "I love you. We don't have to do this. You don't have to die today. I got through my problems. You can get through yours. Honey, put your gun down here on the desk," which he did. And then she said, "You know, the police are outside. Why don't you lie down on the floor and tell me when you're ready and I'll call the police," which he did. And so she called them in 9/11 line. And of course they swept in saying, "Get down on the floor, you know, everybody do this, everybody do that," which was all totally superfluous. And the fact is, she saved all those children, or a large number of them. She said, "I have 825 babies out there that I have to protect." So drawing upon that deep maternal instinct, she came up with this incredible, creative vision of being able to see what was inside that person, being able to trust that she could reach it and that he would respond. And this is pure nonviolence. This is how nonviolence works. And I'm not going to say that it wasn't in the media. For a day or so, it was all over the newsreels and the YouTubes and the whatnot. And I looked over a lot of that stuff, and nobody got the point, which I'm about to share with you. The point is this. We had two ways to prevent violence in that school. One was a very expensive, elaborate, violent, mechanical system which failed, and one was a human being which succeeded. And we spend all our time and money developing systems that don't work, and we don't spend anything developing the nonviolent potential of the human being. If we just made movements in that direction, think of what an incredible change it would make. So I call this picture, "Why Are These Men Laughing?" As you can see, one of them, from the UK, is Derek Oakley, and he is an NP, International Protection Officer. His companion is Andres Gutierrez, who is the team leader for South Sudan. As you might tell from looking at the scenery behind you, we are in Bor, South Sudan, at an IDP, internal displaced person camp, being run by the UN. And why are they smiling that way? and looking at one another with such affection and such satisfaction. Because half an hour before, the camp had been attacked by a militia with AK-47s and axes and clubs and what have you. And these two guys ducked into a hut for protection. And when they got into the hut, they discovered, when they adjusted their eyes, that there were four women and nine children hiding in there. And so a couple of minutes after they entered, in came the militia, and they saw, obviously, there are two non-Sudanese, two Europeans there. They ordered them out. Andres and Derek were well-trained. And let me back up for a second now and tell you what they were doing there. NP stands for Nonviolent Peace Force. There are about 40 organizations in our world today that are practicing what is called unarmed civilian peacekeeping. It used to be called third-party nonviolent intervention, which I like better, but nobody asked me. So this is unarmed civilian peacekeeping. And what they do is they send teams into countries, or they also operate domestically. They're operating in the US, they're operating in Canada. They also do it cross-border, which has its advantages because third parties have an advantage. And NP is one of the biggest. They have been trying for 10 years to build up a cadre of 2,000 people. They managed to reach 200. They're operating in four countries: South Sudan, the Caucasus, Mindanao, where they helped to broker a peace treaty, and I think northern Uganda. So these guys were well trained. They knew what to do. Pick up the story now where the militia has just ordered them to get out. They glanced at one another and they had a moment very much like Aung San Suu Kyi's moment. And they turned to the militia and said, "We are international protection officers. We're here to protect these people and we're not leaving." The militia regrouped. They came in and ordered them out three times. Three times they refused to go away. And finally, the militia went away, and all of those young people and their mothers were saved. So that's why they're smiling. They're smiling because they saved 13 people. They're also smiling because they showed that the world has a mechanism that can actually replace war, and that is nonviolent intervention. So all it would take is a little bit of alertness to capture these stories, understand their significance, and support them. It's been calculated that we could transition from armed peace forces to unarmed third-party peace teams like NP and Peace Brigades International and Christian peacemaker teams for 0.03% of the world's military budget. That's what it would take. You know, basically sell one aircraft carrier and we could make this happen. It's not blowing away. They just got a $1 million grant from UNESCO. But think of how easy it would be if we could grasp the significance of what these people are doing, how easy this would be to shift to a totally different system. So I want to share with you a little bit now by way of closing. I had no idea I would go on this long, and I want to have a time to interact with you. But I want to share with you a little bit about what Metta is doing about this. One of the things we're doing, this was created by a friend of ours right here in Cotati, that's almost within walking distance, it's called the Roadmap, and it's an attempt to create a conceptual scheme which would bring together basically the entire progressive movement. And as you'll see, there are six sectors. The top sector, the most important one, is what we call new story creation, for the very reason that I've just been sharing with you. If we had a new paradigm, a new model of who we are and where we've come from and where we could go, all these changes all the way around the circle would be much, much easier. And we're proposing that people start with their own person power and then advance to a constructive program, non-confrontational ways of addressing problems, and then carry out the nonviolent resistance where you have to. So let's look a little bit more closely at that person power circle, and I'm rather proud of this, and you know, you have to take my age into account to realize what a terrifically slick toy I think this is. So hold on, here we go. Yeah. So this is person power, the heart and soul of the roadmap. And we have five practices that we'd like to recommend, and the beauty of this is that absolutely any one of us can do this. You don't have to be, you don't have to have your degree in anything or be members of an organization. The first is basically the least popular but the most effective: avoid the mass media. They do nothing but fill your head filled with violence. And if you want to protect yourself from that violence, it's going to take a while for you to build up your sensitivity and to know what to look at and what not to look at. I'm not against cute animal videos, but even there you have to be careful, because you're watching a cute animal video, the next thing you know, there's these lions attacking an elephant, and here we go all over again. So just, you know, cut it out, junk it. You know, you don't have the time anyway. Your college students. Next thing I would recommend is a way of filling the vacuum that you've just created by not watching TV and playing video games anymore, and that is to learn about nonviolence. And now, how on earth are you going to do that? Well, hi, I'm here from the Metta Center, and we have these lovely brochures for Roadmap, and I have a new book. I happen to have brought a few copies with me. My executive director gets very annoyed with me if I don't remember to say this. This is a very short book, which will not interfere with your studying for your midterms. It's only $12, so it won't interfere with your lunch budget. And it, although it's short, it actually condenses everything that we've been able to learn about how to carry out nonviolence over these many years. So that's learn nonviolence. Then I also strongly recommend that people get some kind of spiritual practice. People are not always aware that Gandhi's power came from his spiritual practice. You can watch the Attenborough movie from one end to the other, and you will not get a clue that every night at prayer meeting, he would go into a very profound, very deep state of consciousness and fetch up his incredible powers, which made it possible for him to come up with the incredibly brilliant scheme of picking up a pinch of salt and bringing down the British Empire. It accounted for the fact that he had this incredible ability to win people over. I hope you can see that picture. This is at Lancashire Clothing Mills in 1931. He was warned not to go there because his boycott of British cloth had put something like 10,000 people out of work, and they hated him. He had this strange habit. He always went immediately to see people who hated him. And he talked to them for about an hour, and this was the result. You know, I call this picture, "Ip, ip, orai." They said, "We really understand you now." I'm going to get back to that, but I want to continue. One thing that we recommend people do after you have gone through these three things is just be much more personal with everyone. One of the things that modern life has done to us has driven us apart from one another, and that becomes a political fact, which is the reason that our democracy is being eroded. And the last thing I would suggest is get a hold of the new story of humanity and be ready to tell it wherever you can. This is the new story in a nutshell. This is on a guitar that's hanging on a fence in Tomales, California. We are not human beings having a spiritual experience, which is something we often claim to be in Marin County. We are spiritual beings. We are pure consciousness having a human experience. And so we've developed, and we're still working on this as a work in progress. We're calling this charka points because they used to do bullet points, but that was in the old paradigm. And so now we do spinning wheel points, or charka points. This is the nonviolent version of that. I can't wait to sell this to Bill Gates and fund the movement. So the first charka point is to be aware, as that bumper sticker said, that we are body, mind, and spirit. In the prevailing paradigm, which is what I learned when I was in medical school, we are body, body, and body. We are this enormous collection of inert molecules. We're somehow acting like students and professors, and in my case, beatniks, by some process nobody can explain. No, we are body, mind, and spirit, and in fact, we are primarily spirit. I'm putting these out there for you to consider, reflect on, get back to us with your suggestions, and ideally, when we've got them all, got it to a point that you agree, you approve of it, you like it, just whatever you're doing, take the opportunity to tell this story. There was an example of a guy who was asked by Nick Rockefeller to be an economic hitman. You know, let's destroy Guatemala and we'll make a lot of money. He said, no, thanks, I don't want to do that. And Rockefeller said to him, why do you care about those people? So now imagine if he had this story prepared and could say, well, you know, they may have different skin color, live in a different part of the world, but that's only their bodies. You know, as spirit, we're all deeply interconnected. That's what ecology tells us. We are, after all, one family. We are free to pursue our destiny, which is nonviolence. I think this is an important point because in the newspapers, which you're no longer going to read, of course, after today, your family members may still be reading them. And every week or so, they will say, aha, someone in a laboratory in, I don't know, Chicago, just discovered the gene that makes you like crunchy peanut butter, or vote Republican, or drive a Pontiac, or a Prius, or God knows what all. So the prevailing story is that we are helpless. We are cogs in a meaningless machine. And we have to resist that at every single point. And by the way, there's terrific science that will back us up. Last year, that's what I really emphasized with some of the new science. It's extremely important and liberating for us to realize that the source of all happiness is within us. Even when you buy something that you think is making you happy, like in my case, it's usually a chai latte. Before latte, I'm unhappy. After I drink the chai latte, I'm happy, and I foolishly think the latte made me happy. No, my association triggered the source of happiness within me. And if I learn how to connect with that, I will not have to devastate the earth to be happy. And finally, that we are a work in progress. Well, I think I will end here. Not because I'm finished, but because I'm eager to hear your reactions, questions, and so forth, which is usually the best part. Well, it's the second best part. The best part is when you buy my book. Yeah. Yes, Tim.
Well, I just want to let you know that we did put the link to the roadmap on the web. So they all have that on the
course. Excellent.
Some of you looked at it already, maybe?
Yeah.
Or well before the class section. So
yeah.
If people have questions about that, you can ask Michael about the roadmap. Just yeah. One piece of it, if you're interested in that. And John, if you put that other tab on that's on the computer back there, that would be behind me.
Yeah.
That would be great.
Okay, we all, this either means that you already knew everything that I said, or you don't believe it.
Did Aung San Suu Kyi ask Barack Obama to sell off an aircraft?
carrier two and put them into nonviolence. What was his response?
If she did, he said no. You can guarantee that's guaranteed. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So do you or organizations have more direct ways to fix that, to get back to thinking of education
within the first place? Yeah, I would say so. We think of three audiences: activists, which is what the book is for, educators, which is basically what our website is for, and the media, which is something that we're just beginning. So when I taught my nonviolence course at Berkeley, it was a year-long course, and it was webcast. And so that whole course is on our website with an index to the different lectures and what is in there. Yeah, so that's our own approach. It's maybe a disappointing answer because we're not talking about tackling the educational system. I've been in it, and I just was so fed up, and I felt it was so refractory. I think it's something we have to approach indirectly. But I think as students, you have more power than you realize. It's rapidly eroding, but it is there. And you can vote by, which courses you decide to take, which courses you ask for. You can get together outside of class and study stuff. Yeah, it's a serious question that you're raising, and I don't have a ready answer for it. But I think, like many things, I think if we can change the surrounding story, the educational system will change accordingly. After all, that's what it did. Yeah. Yes, yeah. Did everyone hear the question, how do you practice nonviolence in your personal life? A plus for that young lady, by the way. The source of nonviolence is your ability to convert a negative drive like anger and fear into its positive equivalent. That's why I showed you that picture of Aung San Suu Kyi's face. That's why I told you the story of Antoinette Tough. She was asked afterwards, how did you feel when that guy came in with those weapons? She said, I was terrified. But she decided not to act on that terror. Now, in the book that she's written and in the interviews that she gave, people asked her, how could she do that? She said, well, my pastor had taught me a grounding technique. And that's approximately what we meant by a spiritual discipline. So in every chance that you get, every little chance to convert a negative drive into its positive alternative, you're practicing nonviolence. Because if you can master the anger and the fear in yourself, the other person's anger and fear is not going to be a problem. More people to touch. So I, as usual, I had a number of things I needed to do in Petaluma before I came here this evening. And so I was running late, which is a very, I wasn't really, but I thought I was running late, which is a very typical situation for me. And we came to a particular stop sign on Adobe Road. And the traffic was backed up. You couldn't even see the stop sign that we were waiting for. And my mind said, come on, people. And I said, Rama, Rama, Rama. We're not going to say that. And I calmed down. That was a little bit. So now if someone confronts me in a threatening manner, I'll be that much more able to respond in a nonviolent way. And then the next step is, of course, to know the rules of the game, which we never learned. There are ways of doing it right. And most activists, when they launch out in the field, they're not aware of that. Yeah?
What are your thoughts of what's happening in Ferguson today? Well, I feel sad. I mean, I feel sad about what happened to Mr. Brown, not needless to say. But I feel sad that I wasn't able to do this work more successfully a long time ago and seed every city in the country with five or six people who knew what the power of nonviolence was and were ready in an emergency. Gandhi's Shanti Sena, peace army, out of which nonviolent peace force and all of that grew, that was supposed to be people who would be based in a community. And they would do what the community needed doing, to get the people to trust them, help them with farming or whatever they needed, and teach them something about nonviolence. And then, when something blew up, like a communal riot, which is what's happening in Ferguson, they would know how to respond without dropping their nonviolence. So, because the cause is just, all the basic ingredients are there for a terrific nonviolent event to happen. But instead, people are giving vent to their anger instead of, you know, converting it, as we were just saying, and a terrific opportunity is being lost, as is happening in Syria. You may not be aware that before the bloodshed started happening, there was a very effective nonviolent movement that I met the leader of it, a man named Jodat Said, that just wasn't quite enough, you know? So that's why I say, if only like people like us were more alert, if we spotted it, and if we could give it a name and explain the theory, here's the science, here's the reason that it works, one of these days it's going to be enough. We're going to have something in place. Yeah. 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 That's another place in all over the country now because of what happened in Iguala. People are getting infuriated. It's true that it's a little bit limited. They didn't throw stones at that theater building across from the parliament in the Zocalo, but they set fire to the doorway and people are very angry. And again, ya basta. You know, Yame Kansei, the cause is so obviously right. The people are so obviously roused. And again, I've met the nonviolent leaders in Mexico, and they have the same feeling that I have. If only we were able to get a little bit on further with this. Okay, so I'm sorry, your question. How would stopping them watching the mass media help? If we believe that we're all separate bodies, then we are 1/7 billionth of the human race, and it doesn't matter very much. But once you realize that we all have the same consciousness, if we purify our access to that consciousness, it could have tremendous effect. After all, you know, Gandhi was one person when he came back to India. He was one person. He said, I can liberate this country through nonviolence. And everybody laughed at him. 35 years later, he did it because he had some incredible power. I know, there were other questions, so I'll hold them onto my stories for just now. But don't fail to appreciate the power of your own consciousness. And if you take care of it, it can do a lot. Yeah. Yeah.
Do all that because I know for a fact that would put more money in like prison system as opposed to educating people on how we can
fix that
idea, and that would solve a lot more economic issues than we have currently.
Yeah, there's a Greek proverb, modern Greek proverb. Otan anigi mi askeli, klini mi afileki, which means every time you open a school, you close a prison. So if we could, this is one of the reasons that I wanted to stress restorative justice in schools. We could make schools enclaves of peace and nonviolence again. Put the right kind of resources to them, which are not just money, but respect for what they're basically supposed to be trying to do. That could be a center of terrific change that could radiate out into the wider community. But I think the rate of imprisonment in this country is a national disgrace. It's incredible. We have, I think, one out of every four imprisoned person in the world is in the United States. It's an incredible number like that. I went down to San Quentin last year to teach a little course on nonviolence, and I was only one person speaking. I was told that in that group of men who were 16 years to life, they mostly were there for homicide, in that group where people had been going down from Sonoma State and teaching a course, the recidivism rate is 2%. Does anybody know what the national average of recidivism is? Recidivism means you get out, you commit a crime, you go back in. The national average is 74%. So just by giving people the respect of assuming that they're capable of learning and they want to learn something and taking the trouble to teach them, you raise their self-esteem to that extent. And there's a famous prison in northern India where Kiran Bedi has introduced Vipassana meditation to, you know, and it's had this just incredible effect turning the men around. So I think the basic lesson is that all we know how to do every one of these things, but we need to get the word out on how they work, why they work. We need to approach the problem at a very deep level so it does the kind of preventive work that you were talking about. Yeah?
So, one question is, what do you do when nonviolence fails? I know in situations where it's a population versus a government, where the population is a mass, it's very easy to solve that issue, but in an interpersonal issue where it's necessarily like a violent person, how do you react to that?
That's a very good question. What do you do when nonviolence fails? You asked yourself, where did I go wrong? Because nonviolence, the principle, does not fail. Our capacity to implement it fails. And that's partly what I go into in the book, that you can analyze why a movement failed if you know what basically the rules of the game are. I personally do not believe that if you had a nonviolent campaign that was done correctly by deeply committed people who were well trained, that it would, quote, fail. What might happen is it wouldn't get you what you want right then and there. But there's a famous formula, which I made up, which goes like this. Violence sometimes works. You know, you point a gun at somebody, they give you their wallet, it worked. But it never does good work, because it alienates you from that person. He's going to be more insecure. You're going to be more cynical. There'll be more crime. Nonviolence sometimes works. There are cases where what you're calling a failure, it doesn't achieve what it set out to achieve. But it always does good work. It always changes the situation so that there's an opportunity for a better result down the road. So we have many, many cases where if you know what to look for, you see that where it seemed to fail, it actually succeeded in the long run. The most famous case being the salt satyagraha. It was all designed to get rid of the salt tax. It failed, if you will. The salt tax was, you know, they tweaked it a little bit, but it was still there. But everybody knew that the British Raj was over.
Yes,
yeah.
wherever restorative justice is being tried, the results are fantastic. It's just that we don't have the alertness to pick it up and say, this is the system we want. There was one dean down south who was dead set against converting his school to restorative justice, very tough school, so it would never work here, these kids are too tough. Finally got persuaded, he tried it, and now he's like the biggest advocate of restorative justice. So someone asked him, what changed your mind? He said, every time I used the old system, I lost a relationship. Every time I use the new system, I gain a relationship. So that's what I mean by whatever it did in the short term, in the long term, it makes things better. So it would not take long if we could try nonviolent mechanisms, domestic level, international level, it would not take long to see the results. I think.
Michael, could you say a little bit about the Metta Center and how students might learn more?
Yes, yeah. Well, the Metta Center has been around for a long time, but it kind of took its definitive form a few years ago when we moved up to Petaluma and brought on a terrific executive director who's not with me this evening. We're located in Petaluma. We have student interns. One of them I thought was going to be here tonight. Mercedes, did I miss you? No, but if you know Mercedes, she's a student intern with us. So we do have internships and various kinds of work opportunities. And also we have things that we export, like our Hope Tank conversation format, and we have school curricula. And actually, at this point in time, most of the people who are working with us are not even in the U.S. The terrific media person that we just signed on last week is in Panama, taking over from a woman in New Delhi. We're doing an animation. Yeah, see how slick we are? We're up to date. We're doing an animation on the new story with a woman in Switzerland. Another college student in Germany just called me last week, wants to work with us. So we have a lot of volunteer opportunities, people who are writers, who want to, you know, feed us stories, so on and so forth. So just go to info@mettacenter.org, as you see, Metta with two T's, and say, here's what I'd like to do, here's how much time I have. If, you know, if you're free, come visit us in Petaluma. As long as you're not allergic to our dog. There's lots that people can do. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm going to put your address there. Okay. And I'm going to make a comment.
Okay.
So what is your name here in the front? Here. Yes. Anna? Anna, you asked my favorite question. I asked the same question to Michael 2 years ago when I first, you guys did the roadmap about 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Michael, I said, I asked him, so what if you're, I loved his answer. This is why I'm going to say it again. I said, what if you like The New Girl, which I do. Anybody else watch The New Girl on TV? All right. What if you like The New Girl and you're an atheist? I thought, oh, I got Michael now. I got him now. Because he's got his roadmap up there with those two things. You got to have a spiritual practice and disconnect from the mainstream media. And so I was sitting right there and I asked him those questions. And you know what he told me? He said, does that mean I can't be in your movement? Am I not part of the process of nonviolence? Because I'm deeply committed to a lot of the same political goals. He said, no, you can be part of the movement. You'll just not be as effective in the movement. And I thought, ooh, he got me! Darn! You know, I thought I had him, and I thought it was a really good answer, and I've actually been reflecting on that in the 2 years since, because I'm still learning. I'm still learning and still growing, and after that, I went to take a training, not that the other Metta had put on, right, yeah. To learn how to be a nonviolent peacekeeper, to be one of those people. It was a really interesting thing for me to just go through, and I think that's the answer, too, is that when you empty out your mind, I think that's what Michael said tonight, that's what the War and Peace Lecture Series is about in some ways, is trying to put some other possible stories in all of our heads. Because why does this keep perpetuating? What my student Connor was talking about there, why are we keep building prisons instead of students, instead of universities or more educational facilities because of fear? Because we have the fear inside of us, right, I think. And that's the narrative that we're seeing all the time in the mainstream media. So if we could try to put in some space for these other stories. I mean, how many people learned a story tonight that you hadn't heard about something that worked in nonviolence? Probably heard of Gandhi, right? But not that teacher. Tough. All right, so those stories, why aren't we hearing those stories? So that's what we're trying to do here. We like you. Thank you so much for helping us understand this. I hope you don't mind.